One morning, deep in the Australian outback, a young boy hurried to the sound of an urgent alarm. He raced through the forest, weaving through trees and bounding over rocks. As he ran, he noticed a sleeping echidna anteater. Cody woke his spiny-coated friend.
What's up, Nelson? Flew's sounding the call.
Nelson ran after him, and other animals followed. Cody slowed down long enough to grab a stick and pound it against a log.
Come on, little wombats, hurry!
The wombats and the echidna, some birds, and Cody, too, all rushed toward the alarm. Finally, they came to a clearing. Cody was the first to see the kangaroo blowing into a hollow branch to make the beckoning sound.
Who's got flu?
You don't know her, Cody. Her name is Marahute, the great golden eagle.
Where is she?
She's caught high on a cliff in a poacher's trap. You're the only one who can reach her.
I'll get her loose.
Righto, hop on. No time to lose.
Cody climbed on the kangaroo's back, and the two of them sped through the forest. Soon they reached the bottom of a towering cliff. As Cody dismounted, Falu pointed upward.
She's up on top of that ridge. Be careful, little friend.
Cody climbed the sheer rock face, one hand over the other, one foot, then another, higher and higher, until he looked down and glimpsed a tiny Falu waving up at him. Finally, Cody reached the top and saw her, Marahute, the most magnificent creature he'd ever encountered. The enormous golden eagle was trapped in a net that had been staked to the ground. The bird eyed Cody suspiciously when he took out his pocket knife, then screeched in fright when he began sawing through the ropes. He tried to soothe her.
Calm down. Calm down. I'm not gonna hurt you. That's it, girl. Stay still. It's okay.
Marahute continued to struggle as Cody went from stake to stake, cutting the ropes.
Wait! I'm here to help you! Easy, easy!
Before he could finish, the frightened eagle burst free of the net and the tremendous force of her wings sent Cody reeling backwards over the cliff. Cody plummeted toward the ground. In fear, Cody clamped his eyes shut. Suddenly, he felt something break his fall, then cold air whooshing past him as he was lifted into the sky. Cody opened his eyes. Marahute had caught him on her back. Afraid of falling, he gripped her feathers tightly. But as the golden eagle soared higher and higher, his terror slowly turned to joy. Together, they flew past the cliff, through flocks of cawing birds, into the rain-soaked clouds.
Fire! Whoa!
Suddenly, Marahute turned, plunged toward the earth, and skimmed the shimmering river. Cody skied across the surface before the eagle lifted into the sky once more. Then Marahute took Cody to her secret nest. In awe, he reached out and touched the eggs.
They're very warm. Are they gonna hatch soon?
Marahute nodded yes. When she saw how gently Cody touched the eggs and how he covered them with twigs, she gave him one of her beautiful feathers as a gift. Then she flew him back to the forest floor, where they hugged goodbye. On the way home, as Cody stretched out his arms and pretended to fly, he discovered a mouse caught in a tiny trap.
Hey, little fellow, what happened to you?
Oh, no.
Don't worry, me. I'll get you loose.
Cody and the mouse tumbled into a dark pit. When they landed, a beeper attached to the wall began sounding. Soon they heard the rumble of an approaching truck, then a man's voice.
Well, Joanna, what do we get today? A dingo, a fat old razorback, or a nice big... boy.
Cody looked up to see a tall, hook-nosed man staring down at him. It was Percival McLeach, and beside him was his pet, a six-foot-long lizard. McLeach tried to put the blame on her.
Joanna, you've been digging holes out here again. Don't trying to bury squirrels out here.
It's a trap, and poaching's against the law.
Trap? Where'd you get an idea like that? Boy, I think you've been down in that hole for too long. Well, come on. Grab a hold. We'll get you out of this little old lizard hole. You can just run along.
McLeach helped Cody out of the pit. When the boy turned to go, McLeach spied the eagle feather tied to Cody's backpack.
Say, where'd you get this pretty feather, boy?
It was a present.
Oh, that's real nice. Who gave it to you?
It's a secret.
That's no secret, boy. You see, I already got the father. You just tell me where Mama and those little eggs are.
No!
Cody slipped out of his backpack and began running.
Joanna, see?
Joanna raced after him, and soon the huge lizard had Cody trapped on the edge of a cliff. McLeish caught up with him, glaring at Cody.
You're coming with me, boy.
My mom will call the Rangers.
Not the Rangers. What'll I do? What'll I do? Don't let your ma call the Rangers. Please, no, boy.
The poacher tossed Cody's backpack over the cliff into a river churning with crocodiles.
That's what the Rangers are going to find. Let's go, boy.
McLeish shoved Cody into the cage of the bushwhacker, his giant poaching machine. The converted truck had a crane and a large cage on the back, with a cab in front. McLeish was unaware that he was being watched by the mouse who had fallen into the pit with Cody. As soon as the truck roared off, the mouse dashed away to telegraph the Rescue Aid Society, an organization of mice dedicated to rescuing anyone in need throughout the world. Their motto is, "We never fail to do what's right." Far from the Australian outback, in the middle of New York, two of the most respected RAS agents were finishing dinner at an elegant mouse restaurant. The bistro was located on top of a chandelier in an equally fine human restaurant, and sounds of clinking crystal and happy conversation could be heard coming from both. All evening, Bernard had been toying with an engagement ring in his pocket. He'd been trying to get up the nerve to ask Miss Bianca to marry him. Bernard was just about to propose when she raised her glass in a toast.
To my dear Bernard and our wonderful partnership. You've been very quiet this evening. Is there something on your mind?
Well, actually, I was wondering.
Yes, darling?
Miss Bianca, would you excuse me for a minute?
Bernard had accidentally poked a hole in his pocket, and the ring had dropped to the floor. He fell to his knees and began crawling toward it, but a passing waiter kicked it out of his reach. While Bernard wriggled his way across the restaurant, the head waiter dashed up to Bianca with a note in his hand.
And not only more, Mademoiselle Bianca, I have a note of news.
Yes, Francois? What is it?
You and Bernard have been asked to accept a dangerous mission to Australia.
As Miss Bianca read the note about the kidnapping, Francois volunteered to inform Bernard. Unfortunately, Bernard had found the ring and was too busy rehearsing his proposal to pay any attention to the waiter. Bernard dashed back to Bianca's table without getting the news.
Did you talk to Francois?
Yes, but there's something I
know exactly what you're going to say. Francois told me all about it.
He did? How did he?
Oh, it doesn't matter. I think it's a marvelous idea.
You do? I mean, you really want to?
I don't think it's a matter of wanting. It's a matter of duty.
Duty? I never thought of that. Well, all right. How does next April sound?
Heavens, no. We must act immediately tonight.
Tonight?
Bianca led a very confused Bernard to the headquarters of the Rescue Aid Society, which happened to be in the basement of the same building as the restaurant.
Bianca, this is so sudden. I mean, don't you at least need a gown or something?
No, just a pair of khaki shorts and some hiking boots.
Hiking boots?
Once they arrived, Bernard waited for Bianca to announce their engagement to the others. He smiled nervously as she turned to the crowd.
Delegates, we have an important announcement. Bernard and I have decided to accept the mission to Australia.
Australia?
Oh, good show. Now, you must fly out immediately. It may be outside, but we won't let that
stop us, will we? Bernard almost fainted from shock. He realized that Miss Bianca had agreed to go on a mission, not to get married. Before he could think, Bianca dragged Bernard out the door, up to the roof of the building, and into the middle of a raging snowstorm. They could barely make out the office of Albatross Air and the sign which read, "Under new management, see Wilbur." And Wilbur was a sight to see. When the RAS agents entered the office, they found a large albatross bopping away to a song blasting into his headphones.
Mr. Wilbur!
Get down there, son!
Hello?
Pick it, boy! There we go! Let's walk!
Oh, look out!
Bernard, do something! He can't hear us!
Big time! Big time!
Out of frustration, Bernard snapped off the tape player.
Hey, who killed the music?
Bianca smiled charmingly at the albatross.
Excuse us for interrupting. We're from the Rescue Aid Society. I am Miss Bianca.
Miss Bianca?
And this is my...
The Miss Bianca? I don't believe it. My brother Orville told me all about you. Oh, boy, this is an honor to have... May I just say enchanté, señorita, to you? May I?
We need to charter a flight.
Well, you've come to the right place, buddy boy. Welcome to... Albatross Air, a fair fare from here to there. You got it? A fair fare? It's a play on. Never mind. I've got tons of exotic destinations, faraway places, custom designed for a romantic weekend getaway, as well as the finest in-flight accommodations. Speaking of which, what can I get you? I got you. How about a nice mango Maui cooler? Very, very nice. Very tasty. You
know? No, thank you.
The coconut guava nectar. It's carbonated. Very nice. I got little umbrellas for each one of them and a little coconut thing.
No, it's urgent that we leave immediately.
Nothing at all.
Wilbur.
How about a cream soda?
Now look, we need a flight to Australia.
Australia? The land down under? That's a fabulous idea. So when can I pencil you? After spring thaw? You know, mid-June would be very nice.
Oh, no, we must leave tonight.
Tonight? Come on, you're kidding me, right? Have you looked outside? It's suicide out there. Oh, no. I'm afraid your jolly little holiday will have to wait. What a bunch of jokers.
But you don't understand. The boy needs our help. He's in trouble.
Boy? You mean little kid kind of boy?
He was kidnapped.
Oh, that's awful. Locking up a little kid. The kid should be free. Free to run wild through the house on Saturday mornings. Free to have cookies and milk. And get those little white mustaches. You know what? Nobody's going to take a kid's freedom away while I'm around. Nobody, you hear me?
Does that mean you'll take us?
Storm or no storm, Albatross Airlines, at your service.
The next thing they knew, Bernard and Bianca were climbing into a sardine can strapped to Wilbur's back. As soon as they were inside the compartment, Wilbur took off in the blizzard.
Whoa! Hey, I didn't adjust for the wind. All right, we're going to make it. I just had to duck down a little lower, that's all. Go under the wind. Go under it. Here we go. Ow, this is cold. Hey, slippery. Ice. We got ice. Hang on now. Here we go.
Captain, is this a non-stop flight to Australia?
Well, not exactly, no. No. I could definitely say no.
At that moment, on the other side of the world, Cody was still imprisoned in the back of McLeach's truck. He grabbed a metal trap and began smashing it against the bars of the bushwhacker cage.
Let me out of here! Let me go! You can't do this! Help!
Inside the cab, McLeach clicked on his radio mic and PA system.
Breaker, little mate. I forgot to say it around here. You need to be quiet! Or the ranger might hear. Sit down, relax, enjoy the view. Nothing but abandoned opal mines, far as the eye can see. And dead ahead is home sweet. Ever so.
McLeach finished his cruel little saw, then entered his underground compound. Cody wondered how anyone would ever find him in such a remote, forbidding place. He did not know that an albatross and two mice had stowed away on a jet to Australia and were now flying solo to the outback, determined to free him. But first, Wilbur would have to land safely. He contacted Jake, the kangaroo mouse flight controller.
Mothmoon Tower, this This is Albatross 1-3 requesting permission to land. Over.
Albatross? Steve. Finch, wren, scrubbly, lorikeet, frickle, duck, galah, kookaburra, parrot, cockatoo, albatross. It's a jumbo. -1-3, you'll have to turn back. Our runway isn't long enough for a bird your size.
Not long enough? Look, pal, I can land this thing on a dime.
Bernard watched in fear as the albatross circled the tower.
Wilbur, if the runway isn't long enough, listen, you can't let these radar jockeys push you around. Just leave it to me, all right?
I say again, mate, our runway is too short.
And I say again, mate, I'm coming in.
Easy, Yank. Quick, Sparky, we've got to find a way to extend the runway.
Jake and his colleague, a fly named Sparky, saw Wilbur zooming toward them, about to hit the hot metal roof of the roadside diner that served as a runway. Bernard and Bianca held on tight as Wilbur bounced off the runway onto a paddy wagon, then back onto the runway again. With the help of a drag line that Jake rigged up, the albatross came to a dramatic stop.
Don't try and tell me the runway's too short.
Wilbur handed the elastic line to the exasperated flight controller.
Hold this for me, will you, pal?
The taut line snapped back, sending Jake flying.
I go to have his wings clipped.
Jake stormed back toward the new arrivals.
Your captain thanks you for flying Albatross Airlines. Please check for all carry-ons.
I think they could do any fool thing without regard for me.
Jake had suddenly noticed Miss Bianca. He saw the lovely agent step down from the exit ramp and hurry toward her. He didn't even see Bernard, who was struggling beneath a huge pile of luggage.
Welcome to Australia, man. My name's Jake, and if there's any way I can make your stay more pleasant, don't hesitate to ask.
Oh, how kind.
Allow me to get that bag for you. I've got a lot of luggage here.
Here, let me give you a hand with those bags, pal. All part of the friendly service here at Albatross. Ow! Oh, big time hurt.
Oh, my goodness. Bianca, are you all right?
Don't worry, ma'am. I'll handle this. Sparky, you watch the tower. We're going to get this bird to the hospital.
Oh, can't go down, can't go up. Oh, take the bags.
Jake helped Wilbur to the mouse-sized hospital that was set up in an old, overturned army ambulance. Because the bird was so large, he had to be lowered by a crane through the roof. The mouse doctor and nurses wrung their hands eagerly, awaiting the arrival of this most interesting specimen.
Hey, what are you doing? What's going on? Wait. Hey, wait a minute. Just stop everything.
Never. Don't worry. We'll come back the moment we find the boy.
Wait. Hey, wait a minute. Don't leave me here, please. I'm feeling much better now. I'm even ready to hit the beaches. I'm even ready to mambo. Dun, 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 dun. Oh,
Doctor, baby all right?
Now, my dear, keep a stiff upper lip. And they all come in with a whimper and leave with a grin. Off with you now. Leave everything to me. Shoo, shoo, off we go.
After Bernard and Bianca left, Wilbur gazed nervously at the doctor.
Up to it, ladies. We've got a bent bird on our hands. Move, move, move. Bustle, bustle, bustle. That's it.
Will it hurt, Doc?
Dear boy, you won't feel a thing. Launch the bent brace.
Hey, wait!
Using a slingshot, the nurses fired a cane toward Wilbur. It slid under his back and supported the bird like a giant split.
Oh, I've been skewered!
I've already missed tea, Mr. Albatross. Now don't force me to take drastic measures. You must relax.
Relax? I have never been more relaxed in my life! If I were any more relaxed, I'd be dead!
I'm not convinced. 60 milligrams!
Are you guys crazy? You can't do that to me! I'm an American citizen, buddy!
While Wilbur struggled inside the hospital, Bernard stood outside attempting to read a map of the outback. Jake leaned against a rock, keeping an eye on the city mice, especially Miss Bianca.
Now we just gotta figure out how to get there.
So, you and your husband here on a little outback excursion?
Oh, no. We're not married.
In fact, we're here on a top secret mission. Very, very hush-hush.
Oh, gotta rescue that kid McLeach named, eh?
Why, that's right. How did you know?
You'll find it's tough to keep secrets in the outback, miss.
So, which way you taking?
Suicide trail through Nightmare Canyon or the shortcut at Satan's Ridge?
Suicide trail?
Good choice. More snakes, less quicksand.
Then once you cross Bloodworm Creek, you're scot-free. That isn't till, Dead Dingo Pass.
Wait a minute. I don't see any of that stuff on the map.
Map's not good in the outback. What you really need is someone who knows the territory.
Oh, Mr. Jake, will you guide us?
At your service. I better take my arm, miss. It's gonna be a treacherous hike. I remember the time, Miss B, it was just me and 400 of these big giant possums.
He doesn't even know how to fold a map.
Bernard frowned, jealous of Jake's behavior toward Miss Bianca. He still had the engagement ring in his pocket, and he fingered the gold band as he trudged behind the two of them, barely listening to Jake's tales of daring do and adventure. When Jake convinced a flying squirrel to take them through the outback, he sat up front with Bianca. Bernard clung to the tail. After they'd been riding for a while, Jake glanced back at Bernard.
The only way to travel! Hey, Bernard!
Yeah, it's just a little bumpy back here.
Cinch up your seatbelts, mates. We're coming in for a landing.
Hold it! Not yet!
The squirrel's tail catapulted Bernard into some thorny bushes, but Bianca and Jake dismounted safely. In McLeach's compound, Cody was not safe. McLeach had tied Cody's hands, then dragged him into his quarters. He placed Cody in front of a large map and began sharpening some knives. As he spoke, he hurled the razor-sharp blades into the map.
Well, boy, let's see if we can do something to refresh that rusty old memory of yours.
It's yon Satan's Rit or Nightmare Canyon.
What do you think, Joanna?
The lizard snickered and bit into a cracker. McLeach threw another knife, this time above Cody's head.
That's it. Right smack dab in the middle at Croc Falls. Am I getting warm?
I told you, I don't remember.
Don't you realize a bird that size is worth a fortune? I'll split the money with you 50-50. You can't get a better offer than that, boy.
You won't have any money after the Rangers get through with you.
McLeach grabbed Cody by the neck and kicked Joanna out of the way. Jake and the rescuers still had miles to go before reaching the compound. Jake had left them for a moment to look for transportation, and Bianca took this time to help Bernard remove the thorns from his fur. They performed this delicate operation beside a pond of water.
Jake's been gone a long time. Maybe I should go look for him.
Oh, don't you worry about Jake. He can handle himself.
Yeah, I noticed.
I am just sure he'll be back in no time.
Bernard gazed at Bianca, and he thought how beautiful she looked in the soft light reflected off the pond. With the engagement ring clutched in his hand, he decided to try again.
You know, now that we're alone, there's something that I've been wanting to ask you.
Yes? What is it?
Well, it's like this. Miss Bianca, I would be most honored if you...
Look out!
Bernard whirled around and saw a huge python poised to strike. Before Bernard could grab Bianca, Jake pushed him out of the way and into the pond. Bernard surfaced just in time to see Jake lasso the snake, then stare the python in the eye.
Now look, we got a long way to go, and you're gonna take us there. And you're not gonna give us any trouble about it. Right?
The snake nodded obediently, and Jake helped Miss Bianca onto its head.
They're perfectly harmless once you look them in the eye and let them know who's boss. Ain't that right, mate? Now, get.
It's all right, Bernard. Jake has everything under control.
Yeah, I noticed.
Bernard reluctantly climbed on for another ride alone at the tail.
You know, Miss Bianca, truth be told, I used to be quite a dingo wrestler. Yeah, there was this one time. It was just me and 300 of these ferocious mousy dingoes.
At the compound, McLeach took Cody to a large, dark room and tossed him into a cage.
I'll give you a night down here to think it over. But tomorrow, no more Mr. Nice Guy.
I'll never tell you where she is.
Cody spun around and found himself face to face with a frill-necked lizard.
Yeah, you had to drag it out of us.
Where did you come from?
The desert?
As Cody's eyes adjusted to the darkness, he could make out the shapes of other captives. Chained to the wall were a kangaroo and a koala. The round little marsupial looked Cody over.
Well, 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 fancy that. Looks like McLeish's begun trapping his own kind. There's no hope for any of us now.
No hope. No hope. No.
But there must be a way out of here.
Oh, there's a way out, all right.
There is?
Absolutely.
Krebs pointed one by one at the captured animals, from Red the kangaroo to Polly a platypus. Last, he singled out Frank, the frill-necked lizard.
You'll go as a wallet, you'll go as a belt, and our dear Frank...
No, 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 I don't want to hear it.
Frank will go as...
I can hear you.
A purse.
Oh, a lovely lady's purse.
I don't want to go as a purse. Please, please, don't let him do it.
Don't worry, we're going to get out of here.
We are?
Yeah, if we all put our heads together, I'm sure we'll think of something.
Yeah, something, something, something.
Frank scrunched his face into his thinking pose.
Frank, yeah.
Oh, here he goes again.
Take it easy, mate. You don't want to hurt yourself again.
Yeah, we got it. All we gotta do is get the keys.
Oh, is that all? Well, then, we'd better start packing our bags.
No, wait. He's right. If we could get these long pieces of wood...
Cody had noticed some junk lying about the prison. With the help of the animals, he fashioned a wooden tool with a hook on the end. Slowly, carefully, they tried to remove the keys from their place on a nail. The first time they tried, they missed.
It's okay. Let's try again.
Yeah.
Easy. Easy does it.
Yeah. No. Will somebody shut him up?
We did it.
Got it. You got it.
At the sound of the commotion, a flap at the bottom of the prison door sprung open. Joanna leaped into the room. She grabbed the pole holding the keys and smashed it into pieces. The smirking lizard returned the keys to the nail and swaggered out. Now they knew Joanna was just outside the door. Cody and the others paced the dungeon in silence. Once again, Frank grabbed his head in his thinking pose.
I got it! I'll just take my tail and I'll pick the lock like this.
Oh, Frank, give it a rest.
No, 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 you'll thank me when you're free. Look, I just insert my tail like this and I turn it like this, just a quarter turn to the left, and then I push it a little bit further.
As Frank was trying to pick the lock, Jake and the rescuers were riding on the backs of Lightning Bug, still headed for McLeach's compound. It was taking a long time for the mice to cross the outback, but they were determined to find the boy and rescue him. In the meantime, Wilbur was strapped to an operating table in the mouse hospital, his head caught in a vice. He could hear the doctor and nurses talking beside him.
Are we ready, nurse?
Ready, doctor.
All right, ladies. Snap to it.
Oh, let me see here.
Forceps.
Forceps?
Oh, no. What now?
Spinal strangulator.
Oh, that's gonna hurt.
Artery router.
Mother!
This is rusted tight. I wouldn't dream of using such a tool. Bring me the epidermal tissue disruptor.
The epidermal what? Oh, no. No! No!
When Wilbur saw the disruptor, he ripped free of his bonds and jumped up from the table. He ran out of the operating room with bandages and bindings trailing behind.
Mr. Albatross, we haven't operated yet.
You gotta catch me first, Doc.
Mr. Albatross,
please! Wilbur hooked his back splint on a rope and slid down it, freeing himself. He dashed to the window and was halfway out before some hospital mice grabbed his legs and began pulling hard on him.
Oh, please don't do this. Your spine needs tender. Oh, lovely.
The mice pulled so hard that Wilbur popped back into the room, crushing the doctor beneath him. Suddenly, the albatross stood up and grinned.
I'm back. Hey! Hey, it works! I'm cured! My back!
Look out, world! Albatross Airlines is back on the job! Don't worry! I'm coming, you little mice! This is the finest fleet on two wet feet! I'm back in the air!
In another part of the outback, at the front of a small house, a ranger handed Cody's backpack to his tearful mother. Behind her, the voice of a radio announcer could be heard.
In other news, authorities in Mugwump Flats have called off the search for the missing boy. His backpack was found near Crocodile Falls, and local rangers believe he was yet another victim of crocodile attack.
The same message boomed over the radio in McLeach's quarters. The poacher leaned back in his chair and put his feet up, grinning from ear to ear.
Authorities once again warn residents to use extreme caution.
Think you're pretty smart, don't you? Who outsmarted who? I still gotta get that boy to talking, huh? I'm hungry. Can't think on an empty stomach. Gotta have protein. Gotta have eggs.
He reached for a toolbox crammed with eggs, talking to himself all the while.
Everyone's got his price. All I gotta do is offer him whatever he wants, and then not give it to him. Did you take one of my eggs?
McLeach glared at Joanna after noticing that one of the eggs was missing. The lizard shook her head, smiling innocently. But every time McLeach turned his back, she stole an egg. McLeach kept slamming the box lid shut, but he could never catch Joanna in the act. He continued, thinking out loud.
Let's see. The boy's got the eagle. I want the eagle. The boy won't give me the eagle. If I could just find the boy's weak spot, I could get him to tell me where the eagle is. But the boy's only got one weak spot, and that is the eagle. I stuck him in a giant anthill that would loosen his tongue, and then I got him. Got your hand caught in the cookie jar, didn't you? You think you're messing with you dumb animal? My mental facilities are twice what yours are, you pea brain. Joanna, I give you platypus eggs, I give you snake eggs, why, I'll even give you eagle eggs, but I want you to stay away from my... Eagle's eggs. That's it. That's the boy's weak spot.
As McLeach hatched his plan upstairs, Cody and the animals had fallen asleep in their cages, exhausted from trying to escape. In a stupor, Frank leaned against his cage, still trying to pick the lock with his tail. Suddenly, he sprang the lock. The door swung quietly open, and Frank went along for the ride. He kicked the door shut behind him.
I give up. I'll never get this. Don't.
Hey, look. Chris. Frank, Sam.
Frank, you're free.
Free?
The door slam had awakened Red and the others. As everyone stared in Frank's direction, the excited lizard began running around in circles.
Double or nothing is caught in 5 minutes.
Calm down, little mate.
Look at me. I'm free.
Frank, get the keys.
I should get the keys.
Frank stuck his head in Cody's cage, but when he tried to pull himself out, his frills got stuck in the bar.
Quiet!
You fool!
Take it easy. I'll get you loose. There you go. Now go get the keys.
The keys! Keys! Reach up!
Quick, get something to stand on!
This ought to be rich.
Frank noticed a box and a piece of plywood. He plopped the flat plank of wood beneath the keys.
Frank!
Use the box! Climb up on the box!
Close the box! Climb on the box!
Frank grabbed the keys off the nail, then dropped them. Everyone glanced nervously at Joanna's doggy. Sure enough, she came bounding through the flat, headed straight for Frank. The chase was on. The huge lizard nipped at the heels of the smaller lizard, while Cody and the others watched helplessly from their cages. They clamored for Frank to toss them the keys, but he was too busy dodging Joanna. Frank leaped into a pile of old crates. Joanna jumped in after him. When they emerged, Frank was riding on Joanna's back as if she were a bucking bronco and the ring of keys was a bit.
Yeah, ride him, Frank! Yahoo!
Joanna bucked Frank into the air and he sailed toward the ground, his frills acting as a parachute. When he landed, he raced back to his cage. He dropped the keys and grabbed the bars in desperation. Frank spun around and saw Joanna closing in on him. He took off with Joanna in pursuit. As they chased around the room, Cody reached through the bars and snatched the keys. He freed himself just as Frank shimmied up a rifle across the room. Joanna clawed at the trigger, but it didn't go off until Frank jumped off the gun and it fell to the floor. The explosion sent Joanna reeling backward. In the meantime, Cody tried in vain to find the right keys to free the other animals. Suddenly, he felt a hand grip his shoulder.
Surprise! If I didn't know any better, I'd think you didn't like it here.
Let go!
McLeach handcuffed Cody to the wall, then noticed Frank standing out in the open. The lizard sprinted inside the cage and locked himself in.
That's better. Come on, boy. Say goodbye to your little friends. It's the last you'll ever see of them.
As McLeach released Cody from the handcuffs, Jake and the rescuers arrived outside the compound. Jake stared at the huge steel door.
Now that's a door.
There is no time to waste. We must try to get in.
Here, Miss Bianca, start digging.
Has anyone considered trying open sesame?
To his surprise, the door swung open from the bottom, and the mice were lifted on top of it. They peered over the edge.
Get out of here! Go on, get!
Oh, look, Bernard. It's the boy.
And McClitch.
Jake and the rescuers watched as the poacher threw Cody's pocket knife to him.
It's all over, boy. Your bird's dead. Someone shot her. Shot her! Right out of the sky! Bang!
No!
You calling me a liar? I heard it on the radio this morning. And she could have been mine if it weren't for you. Now you better get out of here before I change my mind. Go on, get!
From the top of the steel door, Bernard turned to Jake.
Why is he letting him go?
It's gotta be a trick.
While Cody dusted himself off, McLeach grinned at his pet lizard.
Too bad about those eggs, eh, Joanna? They'll never survive without their mother. Oh, well. Survival of the fittest, I guess.
Cody ran off into the outback.
Bingo.
McLeach knew that Cody had heard every word and that the boy would head straight to the eagle's nest. McLeach hurried to the bushwhacker and jumped in. He drove the truck out of the compound. Jake motioned to the others.
I don't know where he's gone, but we can't let him get away. Hurry up, you two!
Quickly, Bernard! Now!
They hopped off the door onto the bushwhacker. Bernard and Bianca almost didn't make it, but Jake pulled them to safety. McLeach had his binoculars trained on Cody, so he didn't notice the stowaways. The bushwhacker rumbled after the boy, staying just far enough behind so he wouldn't hear it. The truck arrived at the cliff as Cody was going over the side. Jake and the rescuers leaped off the bushwhacker and followed him. When they arrived at Marahuta's nest, Bianca saw a very sad Cody covering the eagle eggs with a loose straw.
Cody?
Huh? Who are you?
Well, there is no time to explain. You're in great danger.
Marahuta?
It can't be. Oh, Cody! Cody, wait!
She's alive!
Cody, please! You must listen!
That's right. McLeish is on the cliff.
Cody turned and saw the bushwhacker. His gaze darted back to Marahuta, who was circling closer to the nest.
Marahuta! No! Turn back! Stay away! It's a trap!
The eagle ignored ignored Cody's warning. Suddenly, a gunshot rang out, and a net attached to the bushwhacker's crane hurled through the sky. It snagged Marahuti in midair, imprisoning her. As the eagle dangled from the crane, McLeach raised his arms in victory.
I got her! I got her! Did you see that? Perfect shot! Perfect shot! She's mine!
The bundle containing Marahute swung toward the cliff, and Cody leaped onto it, grabbing hold. Jake knew they had come too far to lose the boy now. He lassoed the net and handed the other end to Bernard and Bianca.
Hold tight, you two. We're going for a ride.
Bianca!
Bernard!
Bianca grabbed the rope, but Bernard missed it. The net was raised, leaving Bernard behind. He could hear McLeach yelling above, angered at the sight of Cody clinging to the net.
We got her, Joanna.
Meddling brat. I'll get rid of him for good.
Help! I'm slipping! Cody, don't move!
Jake used his rope to secure Cody to the net. When they reached the top of the cliff, McLeach dumped the bundle into the bushwhacker cage. Again, he did not see the mice. He cared only about the precious eagle. As McLeach gloated, his pet lizard stood beside him.
There she is, Joanna. Just look at her. Look at the size of her. The rarest bird in the world. That bird's gonna make me rich. Filthy rich. I got what I want. Now, what does Joanna want? Does she want to make sure that bird stays rare? How about some great big AAA jumbo eagle eggs? You want them? You want them? Go get them!
No! Please!
McLeach placed Joanna in a harness and used the crane to lower her over the cliff. The lizard licked her lips when she saw the perfectly round, grayish eggs. She grabbed an egg and bit down on it. One of her teeth clattered to the ground. The egg was hard as a rock. She tossed it over the edge. Up above, McLeach was growing impatient.
Joanna! You hurry up and eat those eggs and get your tail up here! Move it!
The lizard tried biting into one egg, then another, all with the same result. Out of frustration, she tossed the remaining eggs over the cliff and tugged on the harness for McLeach to lift her. Once she was gone, Bernard came out from under the nest.
Okay, you guys, she fell for it. Looks like the coast is clear.
Bernard had substituted smooth rocks for the eggs. As he was uncovering the real eggs, something crashed into the nest.
Girls! Girls, I'm here! Where are you, you little chickies, you?
Wilbur?
Come on, where's the party?
Wilbur!
Bernard surprised the albatross so much that he tumbled backwards over the cliff. Bernard inched toward the edge. Wilbur popped his head back up.
Don't ever do that to me again! Oh, boy! I lost a lot of feathers on that one.
Wilbur, am I glad to see you. Give me a hand with these eggs, will you?
Yeah, sure.
Wait a minute.
What the heck are you doing up here anyway?
The kidnapper took the boy and Jake. Miss Bianca.
Miss Bianca? Miss Bianca's in trouble? Whoa! Hey, well, that's terrible. We gotta do something. Bernard, I'm disappointed in you. Hiding under a nest while Miss Bianca needs our help.
I gotta talk to you, mister.
Wilbur.
Yeah.
You should start searching the desert for her, and I'll scan the coastline.
Wilbur.
That's what I'll do. I'll let the chicks on the
Wilbur.
Beach. Huh? What?
Now listen. There's some chicks right here that need your help.
Really?
Bernard leaned on the egg, smiling sweetly.
Oh, no. Wait a minute. Hold it. I know what you're thinking. And you're wrong. Don't even... No. Don't look at me like that. You get no from me. You understand? No. I will not ever sit on those eggs.
Before Wilbur knew what had happened, Bernard was halfway up the cliff and the albatross was sitting on the eggs.
Nuts. Gotta learn to be more assertive. No is no is no. Hey, quit moving in there.
When Bernard reached the cliff top, the bushwhacker was nowhere to be seen. Its tire tracks stretched far into the outback. It would take days for Bernard to catch up with the others. Wiping his brow, he plodded ahead anyway. In the bushwhacker, McLeach pushed the accelerator to the floor.
Well, Joanna, it looks like Lady Luck has finally decided to smile on us. Everything's going our way.
You can't do this! You're gonna get in big trouble! I'll tell the Rangers where you are!
I almost forgot. We got a loose end to tie up.
Joanna sniggered with delight as her master headed toward Crocodile Falls. In the back of the truck, Cody slumped against the cage. Miss Bianca climbed up on his knee.
Now, Cody, we mustn't lose hope. Bernard is still out there.
That's right. If anyone can get us out of this scrape, it's all Bernard. Nice bluff, Miss B.
I wasn't bluffing. You don't know Bernard like I do. He'll never give up.
Miss Bianca stared behind them at the tire tracks cutting across the desert, and her hopeful look creased into one of concern. Bernard was not about to give up, but it seemed to him as though he'd been running forever and wasn't getting any closer. Sweaty and exhausted, he paused to rest. He heard a strange sound, something snoring. A razorback hog was sleeping nearby. Bernard gulped and approached the large animal.
Excuse me.
Bernard lunged forward and grabbed the razorback's snout. He stared the beast in the eye.
Now look, I've got a long way to go. You're gonna take me there, and you're not gonna give me any trouble about it, right? Good. Now get.
After the razorback whined in consent, Bernard ran up its nose and sat on its head. They took off down the long dirt road. At the end of that road was a river which dumped into a thundering waterfall. When McLeach pulled up to the river, he yanked Cody out of the cage. He bound Cody's arms to his sides with a thick rope.
Are you ready, boy? It's time you learned how to fish for crocs. They like it when you use live bait. And you're as live as they come.
McLeach hooked the rope to the end of the bushwhacker crane. Then he used the controls to maneuver Cody out over the river. The boy dangled in midair. From the cage, Marahute, Jake, and Bianca watched in fear. They could see crocodiles slipping off the bank and into the water. Slowly, the police lowered the rope holding Cody.
That's right, babies! Summertime!
Cody's shoes dripped with spray from the river. The crocodiles opened their jaws in anticipation. They tightened the circle beneath him. As the boy kicked in desperation, the bushwhacker engines went dead. And the crane stopped. Furious, McLeach jiggled the controls.
What the blaze is going on here? Joanna!
Something caught the poacher's eye. He saw an animal dash from the cab of the truck. He jumped off the crane and collared Joanna.
Did you know there was a razorback in my truck? Did you?
There was a razorback in my truck! Now you quit playing around with your job.
As Joanna raced after the intruder, McLeach looked in the cab of the truck. The ignition keys were missing.
Hey, what happened to them keys? Must be around here somewhere. I couldn't just get up and walk away. Something weird's going on around here. I smell a big fat rat.
Not a rat, but a mouse was hiding beneath the gas pedal. It was Bernard. He had made it just in time. He gripped the keys in his hand and jumped through a hole in the floor of the truck. He ran around a tire, only to come face to face with Joanna. His heart pounding wildly, Bernard fled underneath the truck. Then he dashed into the open toward the cage. Miss Bianca grabbed Jake's arm.
Look, it's Bernard!
I believe it! Way to go, mate! Miss Bianca, Jake, catch!
Jake and Bianca reached up and caught the keys. When Bernard turned around, he saw Joanna bearing down on him.
Whoa!
Joanna chased after Bernard as Bianca and Jake quietly worked on the cage lock. McLeach grabbed his rifle. He turned and aimed above Cody's head at the rope.
There's more than one way to skin a cat.
The second bullet struck the line. The rope frayed until it was left hanging by a single strand. Cody began swinging back and forth above the river.
Adding a little sport to it, huh? Well, I'm game, little mate. I'm game.
Bernard saw McLeach aiming at the rope again. There was only one thing left for him to do. Gathering all his courage, the mouse ran toward McLeach with Joanna hot on his tail. Bernard dashed through the poacher's legs, over the cliff, and grabbed onto a tiny branch. Joanna crashed into McLeach, sending the two villains tumbling into the river. Used the butt of his gun to fight off the crocodiles, who had turned their attention away from Cody. Suddenly, the crocodile swam away from McLeach.
Gone, run, you yellow-bellied crocs! I whooped you! I whooped you! You'll think twice before messing with Percival C. McLeach!
But the crocodiles were smarter than the poacher. They had seen the waterfall behind him. McLeach tried in vain to reverse his direction, but the current was much too strong. As McLeach toppled over the falls, the rope holding Cody broke. He splashed under the water, and the crocodiles zeroed in on him. Bernard had seen everything from his perch. He leaped into the river. The little mouse tried to sail Cody, but the two of them sank underwater and were swept over the waterfall. It would only be a matter of time before they found themselves being snatched out of the water on the back of an eagle. Narrahootay. Narrahootay had been freed from the cage by Jake and Bianca. Narrahootay had swooped down, plowing into the river with Jake and Bianca on her back, and rescued the boy and Bernard. Bianca and Jake beamed at Bernard. The rescuer took a sopping wet jewelry box out of his pocket.
Oh, Bernard, you are magnificent. You are absolutely the hero of the day.
Miss Bianca, before anything else happens, will you marry me?
Bernard, of course I will.
Bernard took Miss Bianca into his arms. As he gave her a loving kiss, the eagle turned and headed over the outback, back toward her nest. From the ground, from every tree, branch, and burrow, the wild animals of the region were greeted by a wondrous sight, that of an eagle being ridden by a boy and three mice, silhouetted against the moon.
I'm out of here. This is ridiculous. You can't leave me here.